Russia and China are building hypersonic missiles, and the U.S. is lagging behind. Can the U.S. catch up before it's too late? Welcome to America Uncovered. I'm Chris Chappell. This episode is sponsored by Blinkist. Do you want to read books that make you more confident and more educated, but you don't have enough time? Well, Blinkist gives you access to thousands of amazing titles in audiobook form. It's an easy way to get more knowledgeable every day. I'll tell you more at the end. So, hypersonic missiles. They're the hot new toys that Russia, China, and the U.S. are racing to get. Everyone wants a hypersonic missile because they're fast, really fast, and they're almost impossible to defend against. What makes a missile or an aircraft hypersonic is that it can go faster than 5 times the speed of sound, Mach 5. But it's not just about speed. Some regular ballistic missiles can also reach Mach 5. What makes modern hypersonic missiles so hard to defend against is that they can maneuver and change course during flight. This means air defense systems can't predict where they're going to go, which makes them hard to shoot down. They move too fast and are wildly unpredictable. Sounds like the reason all of my exes gave when they broke up with me. They said I was too clingy. Turns out, I'm just hypersonic. Here's how the U.S. would shoot down a ballistic missile, which follows a very predictable path.
In this example, the Aegis destroyer tracks a ballistic missile in space, launches the SM-3 missile, and intercepts the ballistic missile before it re-enters the atmosphere.
As you can see, ballistic missiles fly in a nice clean arc. Even if they're moving fast, you know where they're going to land based on their trajectory. But the newest hypersonic missiles can weave around, and they can fly so low that they're hard to detect by radar until it's too late.
Traveling at velocities greater than Mach 5, hypersonic glide vehicles fly at lower altitudes and are more maneuverable than ballistic missiles, allowing them to maneuver after launch in a way that evades radar tracking and intercept.
This is like something straight out of a Mission Impossible movie, without having the hassle of having to suspend disbelief about Tom Cruise and Scientology. So you can see why Russia and China want these missiles. They're almost impossible to defend against, including with all of America's current expensive anti-missile technology. Great. So what are we going to do with all this out-of-date defense equipment? Maybe we can have a garage sale. Anyone want a used radar? Only $40 million. And if you add nukes into the mix, that's a pretty powerful deterrent. You wouldn't want to mess with a country that has a hypersonic nuke, right? Right? Which is exactly why Russia and China are investing in this technology. Russia reportedly used a hypersonic missile in the war in Ukraine.
But Russia isn't just testing these weapons. It just became the first country to ever actually use hypersonic weapons in war, using them at least 10 times in Ukraine, according to the Pentagon.
Well, it's a consequential weapon.
And China successfully tested a hypersonic weapon that orbited the globe last year.
It orbited the whole globe? What did people think when they saw that? Look, in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane, it's our impending doom, run! Meanwhile, the U.S. has been lagging behind. Now, technically, the U.S. has had hypersonic technology for decades. The U.S. V-2 bumper rocket reached almost 9 times the speed of sound in 1950. And in 2004, NASA's X-34A scramjet reached almost 10 times the speed of sound. But hypersonic technology has changed since then. What has changed is the ability to control flight at this rate of speed to a high degree of accuracy. The U.S. seems to have fallen behind in hypersonic technology because for the past 2 decades, it's been focused on the Middle East. Not exactly high-tech rivals. And according to a longtime U.S. diplomat, the U.S. was worried that if the U.S. developed hypersonic technology for military use, it would stoke a new kind of arms race. But now, Russia and China are pouring loads of money into their hypersonic weapons programs. And Russia has basically threatened to use more hypersonic missiles if the West interferes in Ukraine. So now the U.S. has to play catch-up. And if you think America's military budget was bloated before, it's about to get even bloatier. I'll tell you why right after this short commercial break. Welcome back. Russia and China are developing hypersonic missiles to deter the U.S. and its allies. Russian President Vladimir Putin in particular has been bringing them out for show and tell. With the war in Ukraine going south, he's trying to prove Russia's military prowess. And I guess he realized that these guns weren't enough to intimidate the West. I'm a little intimidated. Russia has developed two models of hypersonic missiles. And one of them, the Kinzhal, has reportedly been used in Ukraine.
Vladimir Putin unveils a new weapon in his arsenal, U.S. officials confirming to CNN that Russia launched hypersonic missiles against Ukraine in recent days, the first known use of these missiles ever in combat. The missiles the Russians call Kinzhals, meaning dagger, struck a military ammunition warehouse in western Ukraine.
The war in Ukraine is still going south, by the way, so the message about Russia's military prowess Putin's sending is, look how impressive we look while losing. Now, to be clear, calling the Kinzhal a hypersonic missile is a bit of a stretch. That's because when people talk about hypersonic missiles, they're usually referring to the newer types of hypersonic missiles. The technology in the Kinzhal has been around since the 1980s, so not exactly cutting edge. Remember the difference between ballistic missiles and hypersonic missiles? Well, the Russian Kinzhal is actually just an aeroballistic missile. It's launched from a plane. A hypersonic aeroballistic system is dropped from an aircraft, accelerated to hypersonic speed using a rocket, and then follows a ballistic, meaning unpowered, trajectory. So it goes fast, but can't maneuver, just like Putin. While the Kinzhal travels at hypersonic speeds, it likely is not as advanced as Russia suggests. Lame! Don't you hate it when a guy brags about his totally hypersonic missile, and it just turns out to be an aeroballistic missile? Now Russia also has a newer type of hypersonic missile, the Avangard. Russia says it's operational, but hasn't used it in combat yet. Putin's a big fan of hypersonic missiles, but no one's a bigger fan of them than China. They're the type of fan that says, oh, you like hypersonic missiles? Name three of them, and where we can buy a stockpile of those. U.S. officials say Beijing has conducted hundreds of hypersonic weapons tests between 2016 and 2021, while Washington conducted only 9 tests during the same period.
The leadership's interest was piqued in part by the growing discussions of such weapons in the U.S., as well as concerns that the country didn't have enough deterrence against its rivals' weapons capabilities. So China has moved quickly.
China's hypersonic weapon has not just been successfully tested, it has been proved for production and has been produced and has been deployed to units.
So China is trying to stock up on weapons the U.S. and most of the world can't defend against. Cool. Siri, set a reminder for next week to update my last will and testament. China's one operational hypersonic missile is the DF-17. It's meant to hit an aircraft carrier, which would be a big loss for any military. But China is also working on developing hypersonic weapons that can hit smaller targets, like small boats or naval bases, or a moving car. Oh, and did I mention the DF-17 can carry a nuclear warhead? Siri, on second thought, set that reminder for tomorrow. So having a hypersonic weapon is a huge advantage for U.S. adversaries. The U.S. can't yet defend against them, so even smaller countries with lesser militaries could have an edge. But it's not all gloom and doom. The U.S. is catching up. In some ways, the U.S. is actually getting ahead. I'll explain how after the break. Welcome back. Russia and China both claim to have operational hypersonic weapons. They're trying to get an edge over the U.S., which doesn't have any yet. But the U.S. is starting to catch up. The U.S. has gone from spending just $2 billion on hypersonic technologies in 2020 to $3.2 billion in 2021, to $3.8 billion this year, and the Department of Defense is now asking for $4.7 billion for next year. Although I can't tell if that means we're taking this more seriously or if even hypersonic missile prices are inflated. If this keeps up, the average American won't even be able to afford an aeroballistic missile. But the U.S. is getting ahead of Russia and China. You see, there are basically two types of hypersonic missiles: hypersonic glide vehicles and hypersonic cruise missiles. Hypersonic glide vehicles are called that because they glide to their targets. China and Russia have both developed hypersonic glide vehicles. However, hypersonic cruise missiles use powerful scramjet engines to get to their target. The US is the only country that has successfully tested hypersonic cruise missiles. And if that doesn't make you feel better, after years of failure, the US has successfully launched a hypersonic glide vehicle as well. That makes three successful hypersonic weapons tests, which doesn't yet mean it's ready to deploy them, but hey, it's better than nothing. The United States' hypersonic missile efforts currently include at least two hypersonic boost glide vehicles and potentially up to five hypersonic cruise missiles leveraging scramjet propulsion. Part of the reason it's taking so long is because the US is focused on conventional hypersonic weapons instead of nuclear ones like Russia and China. With nuclear hypersonic weapons, the blast is so big, it doesn't have to be that accurate. Also, you can threaten people with hypersonic nukes and not actually have to use them. That's deterrence. But with conventional hypersonic weapons, the missile actually has to hit the target, so precision is important. Plus, you're more likely to use them, so they'd better work. If the US is known for anything, it's making things blow up, whether it's a bomb or our own economy. But there are other things getting in the way of US hypersonic missiles as well. Like geese, watch out! Actually, it's the infrastructure, specifically wind tunnels. Those are used to test the missiles.
And there's only a handful of government-run industrial-grade hypersonic wind tunnels in the US. In fact, during a meeting with the defense secretary in February, two people in the room told CNN that CEOs of America's largest defense contractors described this scarcity of wind tunnels as a choke point in testing.
For the big wind tunnel facilities, it can be 1-2 year wait time right now to schedule things out. I'd say 6 months would be pretty fast.
A 2 year wait? Boy, I'm glad the US military is taking this threat seriously. Please, take more of my taxpayer dollars. Defense contractor Lockheed Martin has said it wants to build a wind tunnel, but that it needs a buy-in from the Department of Defense. As recently as last week, Lockheed said the DoD hasn't agreed to invest. That's not to say there isn't interest, the problem is the fiscal budget cycle. Because most military programs are funded on an annual basis, contract periods are often short, making it difficult for the defense industry to make investments that can benefit both its shareholders and the Department of Defense. Yes, let's all shed a tear for Lockheed Martin. So it's not clear when the US will actually have a working hypersonic missile. But if it wants to be on par with China, it better do it soon because China claims it already has AI technology that could intercept hypersonic missiles. Oh no. And that means the Chinese Communist Party has finally perfected technology to control geese. We're all doomed. And this episode is sponsored by Blinkist. Blinkist is great if you want to learn more stuff but don't have time to read a bunch of long books. Here's how it works. Blinkist takes thousands of nonfiction books and condenses the key points into blinks, basically short versions. This way, you can get the most important parts of a long book in just 10 or 20 pages. So you can basically understand the whole picture. Blinkist also makes a lot of them into audiobooks, the short kind and even some full-length versions. Just tell Blinkist what you're interested in. Money, politics, education, and dozens more categories. Blinkist has over 5,000 titles you can choose from, so chances are whatever book you're looking for is available there. One book I recently downloaded on Blinkist was The Art of Gathering by Priya Parker. The premise of the book is that a lot of times we have meetings or parties or whatever for the sake of the event, but it's not really a great use of people's time. This book changed my perspective on how to hold an event. Last weekend, Matt, Shelley, and I threw a big party, and using techniques in this book, we were able to make it a lot more meaningful. We curated a select group of people, and we used it as a way for people to connect in new ways. At any rate, I didn't have time to read the whole 300-page book. But I did have 15 minutes to read the Blink version. And that's why Blinkist is so helpful. It saves me tons of valuable time. It's no surprise that Blinkist already has 14 million active users. And right now, Blinkist is offering a special offer just for our audience. Click the link in my description and you can start a free 7-day trial with Blinkist and get 25% off a premium membership. So check out the link below. The 7-day trial is completely free and you can cancel at any point during that period. So check it out and you'll see how much you can learn quickly. I'm Chris Chappell. Thanks for watching America Uncovered.